Welcome to Research Roundtable. My name is Annette Brown. I'm the Principal Economist at FHI 360. Today, I have with us my colleague, Taufique Joarder from FHI 360's Bangladesh office. Taufique and his co-authors recently published an article titled A Record Review on the Health Status of Rohingya Refugees in Bangladesh. They published it in the journal Curious. So Taufique and I are going to talk a little bit today about this research. Welcome, Taufique.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
So before we start talking about the research, I think it would be useful for our viewers to just give a quick update about what the current situation is for the Rohingya refugees in Bangladesh.
Okay. So first of all, Rohingyas are minority groups coming from Myanmar and taking refuge in Bangladesh. Currently, the number is more than 1 million. And they have been coming to Bangladesh since 1978, when a lot of refugees came to Bangladesh and the government pushed them back to Myanmar, and they have been coming and going. This back and forth is continuing even before my birth. But in 2017, there was a serious problem, a political crisis in Myanmar, and a massive exodus actually took place in late August 2017. And before this 2017, there were around 200,000 to 300,000 Rohingyas living in Bangladesh, documented or undocumented. But after 2017, the number suddenly increased to 1 million. And these people are kept in different settlements. And the largest one is Kutupalong camp. There are 600,000, more than 600,000 Rohingyas are kept in a single settlement. And you can imagine how the situation would be. I mean, the crowding, the food shortages, sanitation, everything is actually in a very bad shape.
Yeah, so health status is going to be a critical issue there. What motivated you to conduct this particular research?
I was wondering if I can do something for the Rohingya refugees. And at that time, the beginning of February, I guess, 2018, our CEO, Patrick Fine, came to Bangladesh. He was asking if there is anything our company can do for the Rohingyas. I said it's a growing problem. A lot of NGOs are actually flocking in Cox's Bazar area where this crisis is basically happening. We should actually focus on that. And then he said that we can actually go to Rohingya response only when we can make sure that we can add value. And I thought, as a researcher, I thought, I mean, the quickest thing that I could do is do a review of existing document and existing information in such a way that could be helpful for the people who are there, who are planning to go there. Currently, there are hundreds of NGOs are basically working. I wanted to do something so that they can be benefited from the information that we can present.
Great, great. One of the reasons that this article immediately jumped out at me is that it's a review. And I'm somebody who's conducted rapid reviews and evidence maps. And so I'm always interested to see how people use these systematic review methods in useful ways. And this is one is a little bit different than what I'm used to because it's a review of basically data documents. So I'd like you to maybe tell us a little bit more about the methods that you used for this review.
Our objective is actually to help the program planners, program implementers. So we did everything in a very similar way that we do in a systematic review. We identified the potential databases. For example, we used Google Scholar, Google and PubMed.
So then what kind of exclusion criteria did you use to get down to your included articles?
Since we didn't want to get the documents which were published before 2017, because this exodus happened in 2017, so we used an exclusion criteria or a filter for the year 2017 and beyond. Then Rohingyas were actually going to different directions, different countries, Thailand, Pakistan, Saudi Arabia, Malaysia, different countries. But we were interested in Bangladesh. So we excluded all these articles which were from other countries. So we focused in Bangladesh. Then we excluded different types of articles, for example, a letter to editors. We wanted to get only the survey reports or institutional reports that might be useful for the programmers.
Right.
And also one thing I want to actually discuss here is that we engaged with the government people because they knew what's exactly happening. The Rohingyas started coming in at the end of 2017, and we did this study at the beginning of 2018. So it was very natural that we won't get a lot of published papers. So we actually went to the NGOs who are working there with the help of the government people and asked for their reports that they had available. And we incorporated those data in our record review.
So you ended up with 12 published articles and 21 of these institutional reports. So you were taking the data from these documents. Where were these authors getting their data? And how were you able to appraise the quality of data or reconcile inconsistencies when you had different sources for the same kind of data?
There are basically two types of articles in broad heading. One type was the published articles, which were basically based on the surveys that different organizations conducted at that time. And the second type was the institutional reports, which were actually based on their program beneficiaries, the people who were coming to their health facilities, and that is actually the institutional record. So right. These were the main sources of the information that we got.
So let's talk a little bit about the findings from these data. So you extracted and you report the prevalence numbers across a wide variety of health conditions. And some of them aren't too surprising. Nutritional status is not too surprising in terms of prevalence of malnutrition. One thing that really stood out, the numbers that you found on sexual and reproductive health, and especially gender-based violence. So you report a survey that found that almost 13% of girls and women among the refugees are experiencing forced sexual favors, and over 8% experiencing forced and unwanted sex. So those numbers, very sobering and very important to share. I'm wondering, among these findings, was there anything that was surprising or unexpected, or that you think that you were able to better highlight than we or the people involved had looked at before?
NCDs, actually, because you know, when a group of refugees come, everybody's talking about all the media and all the people, experts were talking about the communicable diseases, the infectious diseases, nutrition, as you rightly said, but no one was talking about non-communicable diseases. What happens to the people who are coming with pre-existing conditions? We found that 51% of the people were suffering or having hypertension, and more than 14% of the people were having diabetes. So it was definitely, they were definitely on some sort of medication. And you know, the Rohingyas are not allowed to go outside their camps. Then what happens to the people who were taking medicine from before? We are basically pushing them towards death without and non-communicable disease intervention in the camps. So it was an important finding.
And I mean, it is something that we know is growing in prevalence around the world in countries in all income statuses, but I think we still might not have really been thinking about it in humanitarian or crisis response situations, and yet you're finding it's just as prevalent there. So that's a really, I think, useful finding. I'm wondering, I know that this article was recently published, but have you had any impact yet, or what kind of influence have you been able to have?
Thanks for asking this question. Just a few months ago, UNHCR, in collaboration with a private university in Bangladesh, organized a conference in Bangladesh on Rohingya refugees. And after the conference, they produced policy briefs. And one of the policy briefs was on the health conditions. And just as expected, really, I mean, it was focused on communicable diseases and nutrition, some gender-based violence, sexual reproductive health, and not mention anything about non-communicable diseases. I was present in that policy dialogue, and I actually pulled out my findings and said that, look, this is the situation of the non-communicable diseases, and this definitely needs to be addressed. And it actually caught the attention of the policymakers who were present there. And
That is really great. So it's so seldom that we're able to have that kind of immediate impact with the research that we conduct. I want to thank you very much, Taufique Joarder from our Bangladesh office, for joining me today on Research Roundtable. And I hope that our viewers join us for another episode of Research Roundtable. Thank you.